Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture, and hopefully the most Renaissance man-like manner in which arts and culture may be discussed. So, I happened to remember yesterday that I had made a video quite a few months ago called Contrasting Edgar Wright's Top 1000 List. Available at mubi.com, M-U-B-I. In that video, contrasting Edgar Wright's top 1000 to my hypothetical list. Now, I realized that to talk about my hypothetical list could conceivably be unideal to some viewers. Now, I realized that large amounts of what little audiences my channel has been able to get very conceivably do not care about me having an actual top 1000 list, which then could be contrasted to Edgar Wright's top 1000 list. But in the event that there are any viewers who do care, I'm not going to provide the top 1000 right here, because these vlogs are hardly the ideal platform to deliver a top 1000. But I've actually compiled the list already. The problem is that it's not in the kind of chronological order that Edgar Wright's list is. And it's certainly not in ranked order. So what I'll do is I'll explain the structure to my top 1000 in this video to whomever it may be of any use for. So anyway, just so there would be some slight closure to that Edgar Wright trilogy that those two earlier videos, the first one of first Irish murder king Edgar Wright's list, and hopefully some people will watch those earlier videos if they are watching this video. So the first video is Irish Murdoch Edgar Wright's Top 1000 Like a Gentleman. The slightly opaque title is explained in the video. And then the second video was Contrasting Edgar Wright's Top 1000 to My Hypothetical List. So this video, I think, showcases whether my initial assumptions as displayed in the Contrasting Edgar Wright's Top 1000 to My Hypothetical List. This video showcases whether my initial assumptions were correct or incorrect. So anyway, without further ado, I'll explain the structure to my top 1000. That should go a long way to giving you an idea what the final list looks like without me having to actually deliver on the final list. So anyway, I decided to divide my the films that are contenders for the top 1000. I decided to divide them by country. So I wrote my top 100 list for Finnish cinema. The first one, that video is uploaded on YouTube. So my number one favorite Finnish movie is a Mika Kaurismäki movie called Arvottomat. And on the current, you know, I don't know whether to call it 1.0 or 2.0, because this, I think this is more like a 2.0, because it had quite a bit of turnover. The current number 100 place is a film called Mosku, set in Lapland. I think Olli Soinio was the screenwriter, and was Tapio Suominen, the director. But anyway, so between 1 and 100, from Arvottomat to Moskva, I've committed to having all of those 100 in my top 1,000 personal favorite movies. So, you know, a solid 10% will be from Finland. Now, Edgar Wright also had a higher degree of British movies on his list than certainly I have, or say Jonathan Rosenbaum has on his top 1,000, or perhaps even They Shoot Pictures don't they have on their top 1,000. So Edgar Wright similarly had quite domestic, some might call over representation, but I have taken Finnish cinema under my wings, as it were, in a bigger way in recent years than ever before in my life. So I have a video on this channel called My Top 100 Finnish Films, and all of those will be on the top 1,000. Now there will be some slight turnover when I'll do a 3.0 and 4.0 of my top 100 Finnish films, because there's still a couple of films that I haven't seen, and I obviously reserve the right to slightly adjust this list. So similarly, as I have my top 100 Finnish films uploaded on this channel, I also have my top 100 French films and Japanese films. So I've also decided that 10% of the top 1,000 will be Japanese films and 10% will be French films. And so that's already 300 films off the board with just three countries. And then as for the 700 remaining ones, this is where things get a bit more difficult. So what I've decided to do is that I've had English language movies as the remaining category. No other country beside Finland, France and Japan I thought merited a top 100. Now, that's not to say that you couldn't make a top 100 you can obviously make a top 100 Italian movies or top 100 Chinese movies and so on. But the problem is that those aren't... I don't have 100 personal favorites that could possibly make up 10% of my top 1,000 personal favorites. So what I did was that I decided to compile a list of my top 50 Russian movies, my top 20 Polish movies, my top 20 Hungarian movies, my top 20 movies from the Czech Republic, my top 50 Italian movies, my top 25 Spanish language movies, my top 25 greater Scandinavian movies, so basically the Northern European countries minus Finland. So Sweden, Norway, Denmark and Iceland will have my favorites of those countries in the so-called greater Scandinavian cinema list. And then my top 40 German language cinema, which will have movies from Germany, Austria and Switzerland, if they would have any German language movies, although I can't offhand remember. So basically just Germany and Austria. My top 10 Benelux country movies, mainly the Netherlands, but we'll see. I mean, that part is just heavily under construction. And then my top 10 Portuguese language cinema. And then a top 20 remaining Eastern European cinema. Remaining Eastern cinema, I suppose I should say, because films from Georgia or, such films as Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors by Sergei Parachanov. I don't know to what culture some people tend to attribute those, but I decided to create this kind of a top 20 Eastern cinema because I don't know where else to put them, because I don't quite have enough material for more specific regional top 10s. Like, I can't really do a top 10 Georgian films. It would be a bit of a stretch, and that Benelux country cinema top 10 is shaping up to be a bit of a stretch, as is the Greek cinema top 10. I really do have to work a bit harder to really fill out that Greek cinema top 10. Then there's the Vietnamese and Thailand cinema top 10 and African cinema top 10. Then the remaining Asia is Chinese cinema top 50, South Korea top 20, Indian cinema top 20, and Middle Eastern cinema top 20. As I read all of this, the Italian list, the Spanish language list, the Greater Scandinavian list, the Russian list, Polish, Hungarian, Czechoslovakian, German language, Portuguese language, Benelux country, Africa, Vietnam and Thailand, remaining Eastern cinema, Greek cinema, Indian cinema, Middle Eastern, South Korea and China. What happens is that if Finland, France and Japan took around 300 spots, I will use these regional lists to take around 300 selections. And so, logically, it leaves around 400 selections for the English language selections. So, from an Anglo-American standpoint, my list would be around 60% foreign films, around 40% English language films. And I broke down the English selections based on high-profile directors such as Alfred Hitchcock, Billy Wilder, Orson Welles, Michael Powell, Charles Chaplin, John Ford, Francis Ford Coppola, Martin Scorsese, etc. So I made the high-profile director selections first, and then I had a chronological list of the also-ran movies, such as Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, or LA Confidential, or With Nile and I, or Ghostbusters, or Paper Moon, so on. I have I'm guessing that I have a pool of around 500 English language favorites that I just have to narrow down to 400. But if I return to these regional listings, just because, I'm looking at the South Korean selection right now, and in this 2.0 version. I put a fairly recent, I guess you could call it some sort of a horror film called The Howling at number 20. I put Spring, Summer, Fall, Winter and Spring at number 1, although there's a strange, almost like a six-way tie, or maybe you could even stretch it, like, the difference between my favorite Korean film and the ninth favorite, or, you know, you could even, like, the gap between number 1 and number 12 in the Korean selections, if Memories of Murder at number 12, it is at a set distance, but like, you know, Save the Green Planet at number 5 or Three Iron at number 9, like those are incredibly close to the number 1 spot. And, you know, The Howling at number 20, I could certainly, like those 18, 19 and 20 spots, Joint Security Area at number 18, The Bow from Kim Ki-duk at number 19, and The Howling, at number 20. I'm assuming that all of those 20 South Korean films will be on the final top 1,000, but then in my top 20 for Indian cinema, which is not yet finished as a list, quite a few of these are still a bit under construction, but I don't suppose that I'll actually have 20 Indian movies in there. So I will use this kind of Indian cinema top 20, Middle Eastern cinema top 20, you know, Portuguese language cinema top 10, Benelux country cinema top 10. I'll just use them as reference list, and maybe I'll only pick, you know, 4 films, you know, like, it's easy to say that something like Character or The Fourth Man from the Netherlands, those probably will be, or not probably, but they will be in the top 1,000, but then whatever I'll, you know, if I'll put something like Man Bites Dog to the number 8 spot or something, or Soldiers of Orange at the number 10 spot, I don't see those necessarily being on the list, but the reason why I just I have these selections, if I have around 500 English language titles and around 800 or perhaps around, yes, perhaps around 700 or 800 foreign language films, and obviously those would drastically exceed the 1,000 spots on the list. It's difficult, like, it's as if there are tiers of favorites, and I'm sure Edgar Wright could speak to this as well on his list, in that there's a core group of, you know, big favorites that are really, you know, your favorite films of all time. Then there's a secondary tier of solid favorites that you cannot imagine your, say, top 1,000 list of being without. But that's still, you know, maybe something like 700 films. And then the final, the third tier maybe is around 800 films, where you can easily see them being on the top 1,000, but you can also see that you just have to prioritize something else over it. So so that's why I allow this regionalist of being a bit bigger than they need to be for me to feel the adaptation, because if I recently added something like Jupiter's Moon at number 17 to the Hungarian Cinema Top 20, I actually don't expect it to make the top 1000. Or if I added Diamonds of the Night at number 15 to the Czechoslovakian or Czech Republic Slovakia selections, I don't necessarily expect Diamonds of the Night to be on the top 1000. Now, that's not to say that I don't like those movies, it's just that if the first two tiers are around 750 titles, and let's say for the sake of argument that the third tier for me would be 500 titles. So anyway, from 500 fairly equal favorites, I have to just somehow pick 250 movies that I feel somehow slightly more sentimentally attached to, and then 250 movies that I have some regard for, but they just have to be cut. So, obviously, that's why some films like Diamonds of the Night, very possibly, it's just, I'm already assuming that it won't be there. Now, you know, if I look at this list in general, obviously the bigger regional list is, so you know, my Italian top 50 right now, the number 50 selection is a Michelangelo Antonioni movie called The Lady Without Camellias. The number 49 selection is a slightly more obscure drama called Cronaca Familiare. And I'm assuming that all 50 Italian films will make it. Just like I'm assuming that that very close to all 50 of my top 50 Russian films will make the list. And I'm strongly assuming that all 50 of my, well, what I called greater Chinese cinema top 50. So I don't want to have separate list for mainland Chinese movies, Hong Kong movies, and movies from Taiwan. So I'll just use the kind of largest possible definition for you know, films from the Chinese cultural heritage areas, because I don't want to spend time thinking about on which Chinese list I should put something like Ang Lee's Last Caution or something. So you know, that's why you know, the when I'll put the Taiwanese stuff in there, just so like I use this regional list as reference points for the final list, but anyway, so that's why I assume that the greater Chinese cinema, the Russian cinema, and the Italian cinema will have a top 50. And the reason why I didn't make a German language cinema top 50 is because if currently I put The Lives of Others at number 37, I put Das Boot and Coup de Grâce by Volker Schlöndorff at 32 and 34. I do expect Das Boot to probably make the top 1000, but Lives of Others just a few spots below. I'm already feeling a bit a bit shakier, and basically if I feel a bit unsure whether just 40 German language movies would, you know, films like Goodbye Lenin, Der Brücke, Klassenverhältnisse from Straub and Willer, The Seventh Continent, The Last Love, Kameradschaft from the middle of my German language list. Those types of films I more than expect to make the list. You know, Coup de Grâce from Schlöndorff, you know, it's an atmospheric, well-made movie, but do I get, you know, do I have some sort of a sentimental attachment to it? No, that would be a stretch. And then, you know, that's what creates slight difficulties. And, you know, I want to say that from the first, I was very sympathetic towards Edgar Wright in the sense that I realized that he had to deal with situations like this. In that, let's say that there's an art house classic from, say, the new German cinema that Edgar Wright thought was a very well-made movie, but it wasn't a personal favorite. So I'm in those kinds of situations that I could easily do a top 50 German language movies list. And, you know, I'll just put a bunch of Werner Herzog movies in there. But the problem is that if whatever I put at number 47, if it has no prayer of making the actual top 1,000 because, you know, number 37 in all likelihood won't make it. Now, if you like The Lives of Others movie, there is this problem with redundancy. So if there's a Czechoslovakian new wave movie called The Year, if The Year, if some movie like Parallax View, some movie like The Conversation from Francis Ford Coppola and The Lives of Others, like I cannot give 4 spots in the top 1,000 to something that is rather similar as an experience. So that's why, you know, if some of you think that The Lives of Others is a huge modern classic of, say, continental European cinema, and you're like, why do I not appreciate it more? I appreciate that movie just fine. The problem is that I appreciate The Conversation by Coppola so much more, The Year from Czechoslovakia so much more, and probably even Parallax View quite a bit more. So the redundancy issue, like, you know, with Paul Verhoeven, I don't know if there's any point in having The Fourth Man and Basic Instinct both on the list, because they are basically the same movie. Like, Basic Instinct is an unofficial remake of The Fourth Man. It's the same story. The problem is that, you know, Basic Instinct, no pun intended, I basically think that it's the better movie. The problem is that The Fourth Man is the more interesting movie. I'm probably going to leave, like, again, this sounds strange to say, because I consider Basic Instinct is better made as far as its production value is concerned. That's just my opinion. But I'm probably going to drop Basic Instinct because of that redundancy factor. I'm going to drop it over The Fourth Man because The Fourth Man has this kind of... slight exotic live wire quality to it because of the more art housey, style of it. So, you know, there are those kinds of situations to focus on. So, again, you know, just because I didn't put a top 50 for the German language entries doesn't mean that I don't regard German language cinema that much. It's just that ultimately those aren't personal favorites enough. And the reason why I made the Irish Murder King video is because just like Edgar Wright gave this kind of introduction to his list of please don't keep spamming me asking where is insert classic, as if there's only two options: either it's on the list and I love it, or it's not on the list and I must hate it, or I must not have seen it. There's the option that I have seen it and I like it, it's just not in the core group of top 1000 personal favorites. And it might be on the third tier of films that I strongly considered for the list. So that's why I have this slightly larger, top 10 Greek cinema list, top 10 Portuguese language films. So, Pedro Costa's Blood is at number 1, Silvestre is at number 2, Terra in Transe is number 3 from Club Rocha, No or The Vainglory of Command is number 4. So I expect all of those to be on the list. I'm not yet sure how I'll fill the rest of that top 10, I'll have to consider some Manuel de Oliveira and Raul Ruiz and, whatever options that might be there, and then some of the other classics from Brazilian cinema. But the reason why I had a top 10 rather than top 5 Portuguese language cinema is because I want to give due consideration to more than 1000 movies, but in all likelihood, there's no way that there'll be 10 Benelux country movies on the list, or that there'll be 20 movies from either the Czech Republic or Slovakia. I'm kind of showcasing my process in a way that Edgar Wright didn't, not saying that he should have, but I'm displaying my process in that how it is that some movies are missing the cut. So if I'll read the tail end of my Russian cinema top 50, so Battleship Potemkin, or some might want to say Potemkin, but forgive me for saying Potemkin. Battleship Potemkin at number 48. The Living Corpse at number 49. And By the Law at number 50. So three silent film classics. Now, some people might think that why is Potemkin so low? But that's the fundamental, if you look at my list and look at why is Battleship Potemkin only at number 48, to me that's a sign of strength, not a sign of weakness. So, By the Law, The Living Corpse and Battleship Potemkin, I think they are all quality silent films. If I had a top 100 silent films list, those would be all there. I think they are genuinely top tier classics from the silent era. Now, the reason why people, if I had a top 50 Russian films, if instead of making a top 50, I made a top 100, obviously, rather than Battleship Potemkin being near the end, it would be nearer the top because it's double the spots. But the problem is that whatever I would then put at number 68 number 73, number 84. Those wouldn't be the biggest personal favorites. So, when selecting for the top 1000, I really do think that films like Battleship Potemkin, The Living Corps, By the Law, I think those will be the kinds of movies that will make the very final final spots. And that's why I tried to select, I tried to give reasonable range to these selections. So my top 20 Hungarian movies, Werkmeister Harmonies by Pelletier being at number 1 right now, some films like Father being at number 12 and The Red and the White being at number 14, Jupiter's Moon being at number 17. I haven't yet filtered that. I don't expect that there be 20 Hungarian films, but I feel like that's reasonable range that covers the three tiers that I claim that my top 1000 will consist of. The absolutely biggest personal favorites, the core group, the second group of films solidly in the top 1000, and then the third group of, bubble films that half of them will be in, half of them will be left out. And Hungarian cinema having a top 20, I feel like I still need to look at the silent film samples from Hungarian cinema and see, slightly revisit stuff like that, but Hungarian cinema top 20 list, the size of it, the fact that it's a top 20, not a top 25, I had my Greater Scandinavian Cinema's top 25. Number 1 presently is Carl Theodor Dreyer's Udet. Number 2, 3, and 4 are Ingmar Bergman movies. And then, number 17 right now is Element of Crime by Lars von Trier. Number 18 is a more recent comedy called Comrade Peterson. Number 24, which is the lowest that I've ranked, is a film called Ronja, Robber's Daughter. And, I think that the fact that I had a top 20 Hungarian cinema list, but a top 25 Greater Scandinavian cinema list, it just displays the slight difference in the third tier of films that there's a possibility, but it's slightly questionable, whether films like, Comrade Peterson, I expect it to be among the very last to make the top 1000. I'm expecting it to make the list, but there's a possibility that it won't make the list. I'm expecting Element of Crime from Lars von Trier to make the list, but even then there's a possibility. Like, it just depends whether these larger culture zones like China or the English language cinema, there's every possibility that this larger culture zones, their classics will just elbow out the smaller ones, because, obviously, if I look at my English language classics, and let's say that there would be a situation that David Lynch's The Elephant Man, Ridley Scott's The Duelist, let's say John Landis' Spies Like Us, and Brian De Palma's Dress to Kill, let's say that films of that nature are fighting for the final spots in the top 1000, with some films like Ronja, Robber's Daughter or Diamonds of the Night or Lev Kuleshov's By the Law. Now, there's every likelihood that those English language films will just elbow out some of the foreign language competition. So that's why the third tier is a bit tricky. Obviously some of you viewers might appreciate the relative absurdity of contrasting Lev Kuleshov's By the Law with John Landis's Spies Like Us comedy with Chevy Chase and Dan Aykroyd. But, obviously one appreciates the two films slightly differently, but then the question of sentimental attachment comes in hand. And I'll make no secrets about the idea that if right on this spot I would have to rewatch either Spies Like Us or By the Law or Ronja Roper's Daughter, I'll obviously rewatch Spies Like Us. The only reason why it's on the list is because it's a personal favorite. But it is a tier 3 movie on the bubble. It could be in, it could be out. That's what's creating the kind of slight problems with absolutely finalizing the top 1000. And I haven't finalized it yet, and I will not finalize the list anytime soon. What I will do is I will fill out my Russian cinema top 50, Polish cinema top 50, Indian cinema top 20, remaining Eastern cinema top 20, Greek cinema top 10 if I can, and all the rest. So I'll fill this reference list, and then what will happen is I'll have around 700 foreign language films to choose from, and around 500 English language films to choose from. And then it just becomes a question of eventually committing to the kind of, making the tier 3 into ultimately tier 3 and tier 4 of tier 4 basically being what some might refer to as the honorable mentions of the films such as The Lives of Others or Diamonds of the Night or those films that will just slightly miss the cut. But anyway, just to kind of bring this all back to some sort of a reasonable conclusion, I expect my top 1000 to roughly consist of 100 Finnish movies, 100 French movies, 100 Japanese movies, 50 Russian movies, 50 Italian movies, 50 Chinese movies, 20 South Korean movies, perhaps around 12 Indian films, perhaps around 14 Middle Eastern films, mostly dominated by the Iranian selections, perhaps around 35 German language films, perhaps around 20 other Eastern films, perhaps around 6 Greek films, perhaps around 10 Vietnamese and Thailand films, perhaps around 5 to 7 African films, perhaps around 5 to 7 Portuguese language films, perhaps around 5 films from the Benelux countries, probably around 23 Spanish language movies, probably around 23 greater Scandinavian movies, and then maybe around 17 Polish films, around 16 Hungarian movies, around 14 Czechoslovakian movies, and then I think that's realism for the foreign language movies, and then obviously the rest are English language movies. Half of them from the usual suspects of Martin Scorsese, Stanley Kubrick, Alfred Hitchcock, Charlie Chaplin, and then the other half, this kind of one-off oddities, such as the Browning version from Anthony Asquith, or, you know, Murder My Sweet, or Caesar and Cleopatra, or Gilda, or Prisoner of Zenda, or My Man Godfrey, or On Her Majesty's Secret Service, or Mary Poppins, or The Professionals, or Lion in the Winter, or Back to the Future, or Paris, Texas, or The Belly of an Architect, or Office Space, or let's say I want to pick films that definitely will make the list. So, well, Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, I also already mentioned, and I expect Guardians of the Galaxy to make the list, and The Lobster is a recent film that I expect to make the list. I expect The Revenant to make the list. I expect Gone Girl, The Big Short, Sicario to all make the list. A British film called 45 Years, I expect that to make the list. And then a recent Australian movie called Tracks. I think that has a solid chance of being among the very last kinds of films to make the top 1000. Like Tracks, Mia Wasikowska and Adam Driver. You know, a film like that, or a film like Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, or Richard Ayade's Submarine, well, that mightn't make the list. But like Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, Tracks, films like A Most Violent Year or Blue Ruin, or Whiplash. Like, those are the films where it's difficult to say whether they're in or out, but I'm giving them all due consideration, and this is ultimately how the list will finally shape up. Depending on how strongly I cut some of the foreign films into honorable mention status, basically dictates how much of a chance films like Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, or Whiplash, or Blue Ruin, or A Most Violent Year, whether they are among the last year three entries, or whether they will too be pushed to honorable mention status. In case anyone is wondering, rewatchability is how is what I use for tiebreakers. So when evaluating something like Richard Ayade's Submarine, or Whiplash, or Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, if only one of those three will make the list, I will pick the film that I think stays the freshest as a viewing experience throughout rewatches. I haven't finalized the list. I may have talked as if I will do the full list on this channel, but I don't know whether there's much point for me to just do a video where I read out my top 50 Russian films, or where I read out my top 50 Italian films, or where I read out my top 50 greater Chinese cinema list. So anyway, some of you guys, if you made it this far in the video, I guess you can give me some of your thoughts whether I should, you know, like, force myself to complete the list before I feel like doing it or not. I'm not promising to do it because really there's like if I bring back some of those English language selections, so deciding between Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, Whiplash, Blue Ruin and A Most Violent Year, like, you know, there's four films, let's say that one or two will make the list, like, I don't entirely understand why I would force myself to pick two of those into tier 3 and two of those into tier 4. Now, if you'll ask me just for, you know, for closure's sake, since I brought it up, I said that I'll use rewatchability as the deciding factor. So I would rank them. That's actually a tougher, you know, Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, A Most Violent Year, Blue Ruin, Whiplash. I would probably put Whiplash at number one, and I would probably put Blue Ruin at number four. I think it's a good movie, but probably, like, it's a movie that I liked, but it probably has a certain slightness to it. So I'd probably rank Whiplash number one, probably Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy number two, and A Most Violent Year number three, and then Blue Ruin number four. But yeah, like, anyway, those kinds of situations, they're a bit difficult. And I don't know, like, if I'll read on, you know, from also run movies from mid-90s or early 90s, 6 Degrees of Separation, Wayne's World, City of Joy, True Romance, Naked, Sleepless in Seattle, The Groundhog Day, Hot Shots Part 2, The Fugitive, Strictly Ballroom, Demolition Man, The Shawshank Redemption, Amateur by Hal Hartley, Clerks, Leon the Professional, and Speed. You know, let's say that that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So let's say that that was 16 choices, and let's round it up to 20 by saying The Crying Game, Orlando, In the Soup, and The Bodyguard. So that's 20 movies. How many of those do I expect to be tier 3 entries as opposed to tier 4 entries? So The Bodyguard I find quite rewatchable, but the third act, its hokiness is a bit awkward. In the Soup, definitely tier 3. Orlando is an interesting movie, but yeah, you know, that's tough. And The Crying Game definitely is tier 3. Maybe even tier 2. You know, In the Soup probably is tier 2 as well. 6 Degrees of Separation. You know, that's an interesting wildcard choice. Wayne's World, definitely tier 3. City of Joy, probably in True Romance, tier 2. Naked, probably tier 3. Sleepless in Seattle, definitely in Groundhog Days, tier 1. Hot Shots Part 2. You know, I might put it in for old time's sake. The Fugitive, maybe not. Strictly Ballroom, that's difficult. Demolition Man, I'll have to think about that as well, and those, the rest of those probably in as well. But anyway, like, there's kind of There's difficulties when it comes to ultimately fine-tuning it. In that some of these choices are very easy. You know, the Dark Crystal, Amadeus, Return of the Jedi, Octopussy, Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, Nostalgia, Killing Fields, Videodrome, Ghostbusters, Paris, Texas, Neverending Story, Karate Kid, Lady Hawk, Back to the Future, Crocodile Dundee, and so on. Those are very easy to just put in, but it's the last stretch. So let's say that there's 500 movies vying for 100 remaining spots. That's the difficulty, and I don't particularly feel like rushing towards doing it, but I just wanted to give kind of a sense of the overall list. And then in the last minutes of this video, I'll invite you to consider that when I made that second video in this Edgar Wright trilogy that just happened to form, if that second film was contrasting my hypothetical list to Edgar Wright's top 1000, I think that some of the things that we might say about how it is that my list differs from Edgar Wright's is that, number one, I have vastly more foreign films than Edgar Wright does. So I have vastly more non-English language selections than he has. I think my list might have something like between 600 and 700, probably closer to 600, because a lot of these English language films do need their spots. But I have more non-English language films, and he has, Edgar Wright has far more recent films than I do, or I will eventually have. So the loading to our lists are different. I think Edgar Wright's list is more even, but Edgar Wright's list, it's even nearer to our era, whereas my list is, my list is, I think, shallow on both ends, but then even in the middle. So I won't have that many silent films. Edgar Wright didn't have that many silent films either, and I won't have that many recent films, but Mr. Wright had actually a shocking amount of recent films, because I don't know how much of a personal favorite something that's, you know, like just, you know, recent, how much of a personal favorite can be. I'm not disputing that it is. I'm just saying that I'm personally surprised that someone can have a huge amount of personal favorites recently released, but he did. I don't, and then I think it can be said that Edgar Wright's list is, he has this kind of a running theme of B-genre films out there. Whether you think of some British genre films, whether you want to think of Italian genre films, whether you want to think of some obscure American genre films or whatever. This kind of B-genre film became kind of the flavor of the Edgar Wright list. And I would say that the flavor of my list, conversely, is, you know, mainstream movies such as Sleepless in Seattle or the Martin Campbell, The Mask of Zorro with Antonio Banderas. Like, mainstream films like that with this kind of hyper-obscure art house films, such as, I don't know, the Sparkling Winds film from Miklos Jankso from Hungary. I'd say that that's for contrast. But anyway, I want to keep this video under an hour, so I have to end this now. But, you know, if anyone has anything to say, please use the comments section for that, because I don't know if I'll do anything more top 1000 related, but maybe I will, maybe I won't, but that's something to be decided. And anyway, if you like this video, I hope you'll consider liking some of my earlier videos, because some of that content I think is worth watching. But anyway, that's all for now. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.